Hi everybody, my name is Josef and I work as a senior developer at SVT, the national public broadcaster here in Sweden. Today, me and my colleague Armin will be talking about how we got the mandate to start contributing to open source at SVT, a traditional public sector-like organization. I will be talking in more general terms, while Armin will be more specific and talk about our most popular and oldest and well-known open source project, Caspar. So, public money, public entertainment. That is how it has been for a long time here in Sweden. You pay the TV license and it passes through the magical SVT machine and out comes various entertainment, sports, news, mellow, you name it. Now, all of us in the tech industry knows about the undeniable power of open source. And I would dare to say that there isn't a single project starting today that doesn't use open source dependencies or are built on it. And recently, our board has been talking more and more about collaboration with others. And at the same time, many of us developers have felt that instead of just consuming open source, we should act as good open source citizens and also contribute to open source. And well, to be honest, the public has already paid for much of the code, and so why shouldn't much of it be available? At least that to the public, that is. That's the mindset of many of the developers. So, while the board talked about more collaboration here, a few of us developers got together and started arguing that it should be public money, public entertainment, and public code. And we believe that if public service wants to be relevant and modern as an online provider, we have to collaborate and not spend time reinventing the wheel all over again. That is, we have to share our expertise, our code, and our solutions. It can't with others, otherwise we will never be able to deliver a good and modern viewing experience to the viewers. It can't be the case anymore that, for example, Sweden, Denmark, Finland, Norway, whatever, builds their own tools as closed source for their own purposes. Instead, we have to collaborate, and just like Caspar has done, so that we can focus on innovating and creating good solutions together instead. So what can SVT contribute to? Many people think of open source as only code, but we know that there are more things to it. Bug reporting, proofreading, code reviewing, creating feature IDs, and, well, anything you can think of. So, we got the mandate, but how did we get here? How did we get SVT to say that we could work more with open source? It was quite a tough work. There was a lot of uncertainties, fear, and doubts to this. And these were the top things people were worried about in the organization. Security, competition rules, and licensing. And I will talk a little bit about each of these blockers. About security. Oh, isn't open source very dangerous? It was very diffuse, and at the same time, we must be able to meet this uncertainties in an honest, simple, and straightforward way. So we did some workshops where we invited everyone in the organization, and we especially invited the people that were the most vocal about security issues, and we got them to work with us instead. And actually, it turned out that most of the uncertainties regarding open source were things that should be handled in other internal policies, not regardless of the project being open source or not. Things like committing secrets into Git or things like that. So with that out of the way, we had another issue competition rules. The story behind that is a couple of years ago, our most popular project got reported to Konkurrensverket, that is the government organization for competition and unfair use in the market. The case was never escalated. The case was dismissed, actually. But still, that left a kind of a sour mark on the name. When you talk about open source in the organization, you would hear about, oh, but remember when we got reported to Konkurrensverket. And to tackle that, we just we contacted them and got it on paper directly from Konkurrensverket that open source is not a competition issue. Everyone can compete on the same terms, as you all know. But with that paper in hand, we could also kill that fear or uncertainty. And so the licensing then. There the fear was that, for example, we would release a project as MIT, but it would use a lot of GPL code or something like that, and it could make us look, well. And for tackling that, I mean, of course, manual, you got to know your dependencies. That goes for every project. So you got to have a policy. You can't just push something out on GitHub and be happy. But also, we did find some good open source tools, like Licensed, which I can recommend. It's on GitHub, and GitHub themselves use it, I think. So, well, what good is a decision on paper if you don't act upon it? So we created, after we got the mandate, we created an open source team. And the open source team works with, we are a few developers meeting regularly. And we also have time to spend on this. And we call ourselves the in-house lobbyists. Well, we work at guidelines. We try to engage a contributing culture. Goes to talks like this and keep an oversight of the health of the public projects that we have at SVT. This is the work we do, repeating this. It's a big organization, it's a traditional organization, so we have to do much of the work all over again, but it's fun. So, we do have plans, not to worldwide domination, as you can think of when you see that, but we have small plans. The nearest future, we will be arranging another hack day. We had one recently, and the theme is, of course, contribute to open source. We will do some bug fixing in projects we use. We have invited, for example, Sveriges Radio, Swedish Radio, also to that, and we try to broaden our scope and get more people engaged. It's not for the public. Then we're planning hackfests with other public broadcasters, and preferably on our own open source products where we can work together. And at the moment we talk about three bigger projects that we're getting open sourced. Actually, one of them was released just now today, by our infra team. That was a DevOps tool for management rule configuration and generation. You can check it out. You will get the address later on. Also, we are planning to release a video encoding system that is scalable and an advanced subtitle editor handler. Yes, but our vision is more. We devs want to create an agile and open source organizational mindset, not just with code. We want collaboration instead of competition. And public money, it doesn't have to be public code. It could be texts and other things. We will see. Let's start with the code. And be sure to check out our homepage, website, whatever you say, open source. You can have a look there, and also we are always looking for people. So we got a few open positions, DevOps, front-end developers, and one mobile developer at the moment, I think. Well, that was all from me. I think I'll hand it over to my colleague Armin, and he will be talking about Caspar. Thank you very much.
No. Yeah. Hi, all. Thanks for having me here, and thanks to Josef for the great talk. I will basically talk about open source success for large and medium scaled or sized organizations. And a lot of this can be applied to smaller companies or organizations and non-organizations as well, if resources are available. My name is Armin Hafizovic, and this is my daughter's. And let's start with some boring facts first. I'm a software engineer working at as a product owner at SVT. I've worked at SVT for 6 years, and I'm also a community manager for the amazing open source project CasparCG, and which I will tell you a little more about in my session. So, to the fun facts, those two rocks in my life, like as you already seen. I'm worse at drawing. You will see what I mean. And I have a really big dream that never became true, but is to buy a fire truck. That's like, I want it. So let's talk about CasparCG, the successful, fast-growing open source project within its niche, which is broadcasting. What is CasparCG? It's basically a set of softwares and tools for broadcast, libraries and stuff. It's a community-led open source project. All the softwares provided by CasparCG are independent of each other, but together they work like a symphony. It's really powerful. It's used for audio and video playout, to control professional graphics, and for recording and much more. The two biggest repositories are CasparCG server and CasparCG client, and I will touch upon both of these just to give you a hint of what it is. And it's hosted on it's available on GitHub. So just, I won't say how to Google. I assume you can do that. So what's CasparCG server? It's a layer-based real-time compositor. What's that like? It's, let's say that you have several inputs. That can be a signal from a camera, a video that's on the server itself, HTML template, what in the terms of CasparCG, basically a website on the server itself, or flash graphics. Then you take those inputs you want, compose them into one single image, and output it to one or several outputs. CasparCG works on Linux and Windows. As I said previously, it's used for playout professional audio, video, and graphics. It's real-time, everything, including all the effects as transform, distort, skew, you name it. And it's layer-based. And pretend like Photoshop or After Effects, it's the same principle. You build your layers and groups and execute the rundown, and it runs. Those numbers are not that big for an open source project, but for this niche, broadcasting, it's huge. And it's really targeted group of users. CasparCG client is the primary client for controlling the server. It's available for Windows, Linux, and macOS. It can be used besides CasparCG server for controlling other stuff, such as autumn switchers, build mixer in Swedish, remote cameras from Sony, or doing just simple HP requests. The client can also be used as a backend, where you can communicate with it through WebSockets or OSC, Open Sound Control Protocol. And those numbers are smaller than the server, but we have a great support for creating own clients. So there has been some really huge business around building own clients. So that's why the numbers are lower, but it's a primary client. Now when you have some background about what it is, just a short bit of history. I love this title from Jonas Hummelstrand, former community manager of CasparCG. From elections to rocket launches, it's true. It has been used like for a really wide set of productions. 2006, the first version was released on SourceForge. And CasparCG was invented in Växjö by a guy named Olle Soprani. There was a case, and he came up with the idea, and it became Caspar. Until 2010, it was hosted on SourceForge and used Subversion. And 2010, we migrated to GitHub. 2015, SpaceX used it for the launch, then 9-8, yeah. And NASA has also used it, but I couldn't find what year, so I skipped it. 2018, GDPR. We had a really good community forum hosted on... it doesn't matter. We had to shut it down because we couldn't clean up all the data. We had like 30,000 posts and 4,000 members. So it was like a really hit to the community. But we have a new forum that's up and running that isn't provided by SVT or anybody that works at SVT. So it's community supported forum. 2019, I'm working to fix a committee for a project with two public service companies and two private companies to find a good balance as well. And about the drawing, I tried to draw the octopus cat. Not good. So SVT should be glad I'm not a designer. The project is amazing thanks to the community. The output in all axes is just incredible. So big thanks to the CasparCG community. What we get from that is like instant testing. As soon as we have an auto build released, we get feedback, feature requests that we even thought about. Bug reports, as soon as a beta or alpha is released or stable, doesn't matter. It's report on GitHub. We get contributions, community-led support, which usually costs a lot of money, and knowledge transfer. It's really open community. Now when you know about CasparCG, I'm going to internal bumps at SVT and what I refer to as lack of open source knowledge. I'm quoting myself. 2016, I noticed that something is wrong with open source culture. And I told this to some managers, and they were like, "What? It's open source. How is that possible?" Well, it's a project. And I didn't know what to say, honestly. So keep this in mind. So the bumps, and this is what I refer to, the lack of open source knowledge we experienced. Knowledge, what is open source? What does it mean? What does it mean to have something as open source? What does it require? Time, how much time it actually takes, and the attention it needs. just as an internal or closed project. Communication. Who's responsible for a communication internally and externally? That's not always obvious. Response with that and the contributions. What I mean with those two is you need to be active on the open source platform or where the issue tracking and the code is to give feedback on the issues created, reports, bug reports, feature requests, and even the contributions in form of pull requests. The community need feedback. They spend time to help you. Forks. I will say this with highly respect for everybody, but what I mean is, if I as a, let's pretend I have an open source project and I don't manage from knowledge to contributions, then forks will like pop up as mushrooms everywhere. And suddenly, one of those forks will be the new main project. But that's obvious because I didn't do my job. So we're back to the quote again. They get surprised. Like, it doesn't match at all. So, what we learned from this and what we're taking with us is it's basically about knowledge transfer. So we are taking the bumps, and knowledge and time can be solved through knowledge transfer and clear guidelines and communication, what it takes. Communication should maybe be role-based, and in my case, it's me as a product owner that are responsible for external and internal communication. Response and contributions is the responsibility of the team, including the product owner. We should answer on issues, we should label them, we should give feedback on contributions, or just close and give feedback in that form so that the user on the other side knows that we have taken action upon that. That if you manage to have all those, I think you will have an epic success. And what I mean is that forks will always be, I love forks, but they will be forks where they develop stuff and contribute back to the main project. So, wrapping up with the quote again, this won't be a surprise then, if you manage all those parts. And I would like to say thanks to the amazing craftsmanship I used for my presentation. Thanks for listening.
Hello. A question to Armin, if I pronounce it right. So if I was your manager and I would like to take a decision on whether we should continue this open source initiative or not, what hard facts would you come up with to prove that this made sense? Can you say that it saved some money and have facts, or did you say that you made money? Or what other, again, facts, numbers, something quantitative would you come up with to convince me that we should keep doing this?
Could we take the question outside with the team? We discussed, or should we take it? Sir? Yeah.
Why not now?
Or? No, we can take it now as well. It's okay. Could you repeat the question?
If I was your manager and I wanted to decide whether we should continue investing in this initiative, what hard facts would you come up with in order to convince me that we should keep doing that. Can you say that we saved money and have proof for that? Can you say that we made money? Can you say that there is some other benefit?
Like going open source?
Yes, this whole initiative.
Yeah. First of all, yeah, you save... I wouldn't say you save money as money, but you would save time in learning people's, because you have a whole community, then you won't have a single point of failure that we had in one circumstance at SVT. So if somebody drops, you still have a community to go to. I don't have like facts, like this is on a paper, but all this is based on my experience that and CasparCG and how it has evolved from being just an idea to what it is today. It wasn't a flawless trip, honestly. We had a lot of those bumps we experienced in CasparCG, and the key point is to be transparent, trust the community, and to share, basically. I don't think I can give you a better answer. So.
Fair enough.
So I have a question maybe for you, Josef.
Yes.
Where do you find the inspiration for setting up the governance of open source? Did you invent it yourself, or did you have any templates or inspiration somewhere?
Oh, yes. There were the inspiration. Actually, Caspar, there was already ready open source at SVT when we... We're another generation, maybe, of developers now, partly at least. The inspiration, well, we were just, I mean, working with open source, it's just what we do every day, that it's like eating food for us. So it was all natural that the question came up that we also should contribute more, because we used projects that we also sometimes need to bug fix. And then we just took it from there. I mean, if we have a bug, we don't want to patch something internally, let's say in a third-part Apache project. We want to fix the bug so that we don't have to do any special things to use it. And if other people can use it at the same time, great.
Well, one question is really, because I see you have a great approach. You managed to do some policy documents, you convinced the management about the benefits of open source, and that is why I'm asking you, why do you find that inspiration? Because that is crucial.
Oh, if I understand it correctly, how did we find the inspiration? Well, I mean, there were a lot of, there are some, what do you say, middle bosses, or what you can say, they also like the idea of open source. They see that it can benefit them. So that helped us along the way. And also, I think you got to take, I talked a lot about fear, uncertainty, doubt. You got to take all this seriously and handle these questions. People are, especially if you don't come, I say our world, here most of us, probably working with open source in some kind of way. But if you come from another culture, or what I should say, it could be very different with all this openness. So you got to take all uncertainties seriously. I don't know if that was really kind of the right answer, but...
That was a great answer. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any so, more? Yeah. One more. So how? Oh, there was one there.
I have just a complimentary to a great question. You save money in term of if you share like a public roadmap, then we can, from SVT's perspective, say we will focus on those features or issues, while you maybe somebody else said, we can take those, and then another public service company or private company says, we will focus on those, then you don't need to do the same thing in three ends. So. There is a company in Australia that has put a lot of money for supporting their hardware, and we didn't have that in our mind at all, but they took the initiative and did a pull request or several without, and now it has proven to be really good implementation.
Sorry, no, okay, and I just want to add, like, there has been now when we talked, I can't mention any details about any of our projects before they are out in the open, but when we talk about, say, money, we have actually been, I was talking a lot about collaboration with other broadcasters, and actually people from other broadcasters has been offering to send a developer to us and help us with some stuff that they want in the project that we're going to open source. I'm not saying that that will be the case or that it happens, but that is just one of the possibilities now if we do things as open source.
Yeah, I'm curious. Of course, SVT is a huge organization and you probably don't have connections with other people, but considering like free and open source software is a thing and seems to be going well, is there any idea from you or any, like, do you see where free and open source culture, like Creative Commons, free licensing, et cetera, does that have a role to play in public service as well?
Well, that was a hard one.
Yeah.
I can't really answer that. I can give you my personal answer afterwards out there. And we can talk a lot about it.
I have a general question for you. You're talking about you starting to collaborate with other broadcasters. Are you, one, aware about the movie industry has a foundation called the Academic Software Foundation that is part of the Linux Foundation, where they share open source for movie creation. Are you aware of that? Are you planning to participate in that?
Without any details, we have been talking about EBU, but we came across that for CasparCG, for now, we need to settle some things before we can take that step. Because what the project is afraid of, and everybody wouldn't agree with me saying this, so, but it's how would they rule anything about the features, roadmaps and stuff. I'm not sure, and we have talked about it, yes, and CasparCG is used, like, as I said, from elections to rocket launches, Eurovision, Melodifestivalen, United States president, what's called, elections. And it's the most used playout system, I would say, in Europe. And we know it's used all over the world. So that's maybe the next step, I don't know. That's a community question, and not just for me.
Thanks.
I can save you some time, Johnny.
All right.
Can you say something about how you think about ownership in an open source, particularly one that you've developed internally and then you release to the as an open source project which other organizations can use? Do you then think about it as something that you remain the gatekeepers of contributions and design for it? Or if at some point in the future the majority of the community wants to go in a different direction, are they then in That's control?
Well, we might have different opinions, I don't know, but we have talked, as for now, we see ourselves, we have, for every project we release, That's like the kind of the release process. We are one or more people got to have a maintenance role as a kind of a gatekeeper. But we have also talked about that the policy is that if we don't want to keep the gatekeeper role, I mean, we would just be very, very, we would tell everyone involved in the project that we wouldn't be that anymore. We don't want to take the role, but if anyone else should be up to it, then fork it or do whatever. But as long as, I mean, you can fork any project you want to. But we intend to keep some kind of gatekeeping role.
We disagree. It's as he said, it's different projects. And it depends on the purpose and what we want to achieve and how big publicity you want for that project. But in my case, I have several products in my product portfolio, or what's called. And I don't mind to take one of those products, of course, with an agreement from my manager to give it away to CasparCG organization. And that has been done before by other community members and companies, and why shouldn't we do that as well, if it's possible?
So that was a both yes and no question.
Yeah,
yeah, interesting.
It's a good discussion. Also,
yeah. Any more questions? Yes. There you have one. Yeah.
So do you believe that the Swedish Television contribute to other open source projects that you not have such an active role in? Do you have that kind of culture, or do you focus on specific projects like the Casper?
No, we are quite new into this. So, but the intention is to, we have already had, I talked about Hack Days. They are a specific case when you can, I mean, they are very, very free to, you can contribute to, if you come to one of our Hack Days, you can contribute to whatever project that you use in one of our projects. So, and that is basic. I mean, we have the whole, we use a lot, we have the Java stacks, the JavaScript stacks, I mean, NPM, Gradle, I mean, we got so much dependencies we use in-house, so that can be whatever. And of course, it doesn't have to be code. Last time, I think someone did a pull request for documentation, etc. So no is the question. We're not focused only on our internal products. But it should be something that at least are SVT related, of course, that we use. Or well, that seems like everybody is happy.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you.